I mean, Steve just led me to where I thought this debate might begin to go. I mean, there's lots of mixed messages going out about Mumfrus. Mumfrus are being hired by certain political parties as the oppressed people. Yes, they are. Eric Pickles has said it's okay to park and pull your lines if you can't see it anytime you want. So don't blame, let's just not take this debate to its end degree about blanket bans. My view is that in some of the areas I represent, without pavement parking of some degree, the place would be even more dangerous and almost inaccessible. So if we're going to say a blanket ban, that would, in my view, actually make the quality of life worse for those people who are not always, but quite often in poor areas of town. And they do aspire to have a car, which they want. It's probably their most valued possession outside their property. And they do have a sense of trying to protect it. So they don't want to park 300 yards away from their own property. I can name dozens of roads in my area where the actual situation is made safer by limited off-street parking actually on the pavement. So I think we need to move away from blanket bans. My view is that we do have the ideal vehicle to discuss this on a localised matter through the constituency forums. The other thing we don't have, if we've got everyone starts shouting about let's have a campaign on this, let's have a piece of work on that. We haven't got a budget, identified a budget for this particular piece of work within the department. So if you want to prioritise this, I'm quite happy for you to do that in your constituency. If you want to take money away from the other road safety elements of the budget, that's entirely you can do that. If there's a big issue for you, David, go ahead and draw some of those resources away from when budgets are more involved. So let's not start making big campaigns that there is absolutely no budget to fund. And at the same time, we have people actively, Stuart Kelly, for example, actively campaigning, telling schools not to spend some of their spare balances to enhance their own pupils' road safety, which would take more money away from the budget or the potential saving. So if you have a priority, then make it a priority and start putting some of the constituency money towards it. I agree that the work that's been done so far has almost been exploratory and has helped us develop a policy. If you want to take it to a full policy, then have the commitment and bottle and the gumption to put some real resources to it. If it's a real issue in these areas where people are clearly voting about, then there is a chance to do something about it at a constituency level. I think part of the supposed which is already involved in those forums, and you divert it to that campaign if you so wish. Let's not have a blanket policy. The other thing about some of the, I have read this and I find it really useful the way that put that together and I'm very appreciative of it. But it does talk about comparing those who park on pavements as somehow criminals linked to the maybe cases in what reference to. I think we just need to make it quite clear that in some parts of the world, to actually have a quality of life in the own road, do sometimes have to bend the rules about on and off street parking. So I think very much I would make recommendations been suggested that probably even made suggested that those go to the constituency forums and then to look at where in their own areas they would like to target. We can then start to find demand for some costs towards it. And then if it's a policy option, then we should develop that and have the function to make a budget for it. But don't just say we want this do and want that do, but there isn't. I've heard you before, there's no identifiable budget for this particular campaign. It will come from some others in council, highway department do. And I want to know what it's being taken away from to do that way.
Balances to pay for revenue items, which the council would do, and not the school should do. reply to that. I have no conflict with what Steve is saying. At the right at the beginning, when I said you may have forgotten my idea, I did say quite clearly that I believed and understood exactly that the nanoroads are needed to be part of the papers. What I did say was that they needed to be part in such a way that they were clear of the wall of the house to allow passage between the wall of the house and the car for people who are disabled or wheelchairs or whatever through. And I'm not suggesting a whole new investigation into this. All I'm saying is, most of the work's been done, 80% of the work has been done. What we're trying to do, and what I discussed with David over many months actually, is a way of doing that last 20% and just giving people those tickets that we're giving them as part of the road that either councillors or as sorry members or as the police. And the police are very keen to support this, all of them are. All the same, put some of these leaflets under some windscreen. Let's go down. We've done 80% of the work, see. We've done it already in the earlier, and you've accepted that. I'm not asking for a whole new initiative, I'm asking for a completion of the initiative that we started 3 years ago. That's all I'm asking, because it seems to have just hit the buffers at the moment, and nobody's taking any interest in it, whereas the situation is getting worse. So I've no conflict or no argument with Steve over the principle of what he's saying. As I said right at the beginning, there are situations in narrow roads where people will need to park on the pavement. No question about that. But they don't need to park on the pavements in some of the areas I've shown here, and they don't need to cause the damage compared to the roads that are shown here. And all it needs is somebody to have the initiative to make a good example of that, a few people, and then the message will get around. That's all I'm asking to do, a continuation of what's already been started to a successful conclusion in the interest of all our residents and those. Thank you.
I have a question around in some places I've seen where people send the law into their own house. I don't mean, you know, to advertise it. I mean, people think it's stones to say, you're not parking here, you're not keeping your axle. Now, I don't know what the legality of that is, but it will lead to
it's illegal.
It's illegal. The other thing is, why do the council should give the grass visits away so the households own the grass visits? Now, I know that might be, it's surely a legal template.
Yeah, I mean, just, well, fine. The point I'd like to take forward is that we must fill these people damages that are wrecking, completely wrecking verges. And, you know, large areas of verges. I mean, I've got lots, you know the one on Kings Road that I want sorted out that now, and they're still digging out every day. And you just want the people billing for the damages. And as you say, some examples, made. Because otherwise, you know, we're not making progress. Thank you.
We first came to members with this issue in November 2005, and at the time the guidance we got from the Jones, the solicitor at the time, was blanket bylaws aren't the answer. We need to go down specific traffic regulation rules for pavement and parking prohibition. We've piloted a couple of schemes in Jones Wood, which have worked particularly well. A couple in Oxton, Brenton, Newbarton, they were exceptionally well. Oh, sorry, can I speak, Frank? And they work exceptionally well. They cost a lot of money, I think. On average, they cost something like £20,000 each at the time, and we did them over a period three to 4 years when we had enough to do it. Unfortunately, we haven't got enough to do it now. Now, they have been a complete and utter success. I think a couple of people, when we first introduced them, thought, the council aren't really going to be here. They get tickets. And they didn't get tickets again. No one parked on the four roads, all the urges, and any of those roads now. I say that without exception.
So, I need to take issue with that. Hensby Road's got enforcement up all the way along. Until we put bollards in.
Well, we don't like to go towards bollards because you end up getting screwed close, you get bollards and
what you're saying is without a
garage, that, is that the garage area on Pensbury Road?
That's
on Shaw's garage.
Okay,
so I apologise for that. In terms of damage, as far as I'm concerned, we can only go after the people who cause the damage if we actually see them doing it. And if we don't have presence on site all the time, I don't know how we can see that across the prosecution doing that. I'm guided by Anna, which is going to turn that out. A lot of its habits, when we last did it in November 2012, we used the Bitson Avenue as an example. There's a lot of roads off Bitson Avenue. You can actually drive down and go down one road, no one parks on the footway, narrow road. You go down the next road, everybody parks half on the footway and half on the road. And that's the way it continues all the way down. So sometimes you'll get one person started. In terms of King's Road, which Gary is very keen on, when we did the initial pilot in 2005, 2006, we looked at King's Road, there were no problems on King's Road at that time. You get one family who moves in with six cars, and immediately we have a problem. Now, yeah, we've had conversations about King's Road in the past, and to introduce paving policy prohibition of £20,000 to try and manage one location. It's not that. So, further reasons behind it, but I do think the way ahead, there is going to be fighting for this money, we will be able to address it. Parking restrictions, we will be able to address it. And the double point, if you know about double points, there's an application for reading across the back to any type of that. The inspector has also